Hello everyone, I welcome you all to my YouTube channel. This is another lecture relating to study of Hindu law, that is Hindu Marriage Act. We have already done the concept of divorce obtained by way of mutual consent covered under section 13B. So in this lecture we shall proceed further to section 14. See, section 14, it talks about a statutory time period which is relevant in petitions presented to obtain divorce. Now, section 14, it is a non-obstantive clause since it starts with the word notwithstanding anything. It shall override all of the act. It says that divorce cannot be granted. Not only divorce, even the petition will not be entertained. It cannot be brought on record in the court unless the period of 1 year has elapsed since the date of marriage before the presentation of the petition. So 1 year of marriage must have lapsed. Only after that the petition to obtain divorce can be maintained in the court. All right. This is what subsection 1 says. Now, this subsection 1, it is to be noted here that it is relevant only in petitions which are presented to obtain divorce. Thus, it shall not be applicable to any petition presented under section 12 or section 11 of Hindu Marriage Act. That is, the petition presented for annulling the marriage or the petition brought before the court requesting the court to declare that marriage as void ab initio. To such petitions, this section will not apply. Alright, so there is no statutory period mentioned under HMA regarding petitions presented under section 11 or section 12, but regarding section 13, section 14 is applicable. Now, a proviso is added here under which a special leave can be obtained from the court, and if the court grants that leave, petition can still be filed. It can be maintained in the court though 1 year of marriage has not lapsed. Thus, divorce can be obtained before the statutory period mentioned under section 14 if special leave, as mentioned in the proviso attached to subsection 1, is obtained from the court. Now, two parameters have been mentioned under the proviso by following which this special leave can be obtained. Number one is the case is of exceptional hardship for the plaintiff petitioner. If the case is of exceptional hardship to the petitioner and petitioner is able to prove this in his petition, all right, then the court can give the permission to make the petition maintainable though 1 year has not lapsed since the date of marriage. Similarly, the other parameter is when there is exceptional depravity on the part of respondent. The conduct of respondent is dangerous or fatal to the life of the petitioner. In such case also, this leave can be given by the court and the petition becomes maintainable in the court. So this is what is mentioned in proviso. Now, I will like to mention something here regarding section 13B. Section 13B, we have already done it. It was added in year 1976 by an amendment, and section 14 was already there. Can by using the proviso mentioned under section 14, you waive off, you get rid of the 1 year separation period mentioned in section 13B. Now, under section 13B, if we see it, section Subsection 1 says that in the joint petition presented by the parties together, they must state that they have been living separately for at least 1 year. This is mentioned there. Can by using the proviso we get rid of this essential? The answer is no. Section 13B was added way later than Section 14. Section 14 is applicable only to Section 13. The period of 1 year separation under Section 13B, subsection 1, it enables the jurisdiction of the court to grant divorce by way of mutual consent. If this essential is not followed, the petition, joint petition mentioned under Section 13B is no more maintainable. Alright, so 1 year separation period is necessary to be followed and to be shown in the petition presented under Section 13B. No waiver of this can be granted. However, we have already done waiver of cooling down period or interregnum period mentioned under Section 13B of 6 months can be set aside since it is no longer mandatory, as has been held in Amardeep Singh versus Harveen Kaur's case. So this was regarding 13B and the link of it with the proviso attached to Section 14. So in other words, in brief words, I shall conclude here that the statutory period of 1 year presented under section mentioned under Section 14 is relevant as far as the petitions under Section 13 are concerned and not under Section 13B. All right, so we move further under Section 14. Now, how this special leave petition, special leave application presented by the party to waive off the statutory period of 1 year mentioned in subsection 1 of Section 14 is to be regulated? What procedure is to be followed? See, the proviso itself says that the procedure shall be followed according to the rules framed by High Court in this behalf. Different High Courts have framed their own rules regarding the procedure of the application presented under the proviso to subsection 1. Alright, so this was all about subsection 1 and the proviso. We come to subsection 2. Now, in subsection 2, two relevant factors have been mentioned. Whenever the court has to decide the application presented in the proviso to subsection 1. Under subsection 2, the two relevant factors which shall help the court in determining whether or not the petition should be allowed to be presented before expiry of 1 year since the date of marriage or not are: number one, the interest of children. If it is in the interest of children that the petition should be allowed to be presented within one year of marriage, then the court will do so. However, if the court thinks that this shall cause trouble to the children and it is not in the interest of children, then it will not grant the special leave. And secondly, the second parameter or the factor which is relevant for consideration for the court is reconciliation, possibility of reconciliation between the parties. See, if reconciliation is possible according to the court, that reconciliation can take place, then the court will not grant such permission. All right. So, under subsection 2, two important relevant factors have been mentioned which the court shall take into account for deciding an application presented under the proviso to subsection 1, that is, for waiver of statutory period. This was all regarding section 14. So, we proceed further to section 15 now. Now, section 15, first of all, first thing first, section 15 is applicable only to the decree of divorce. okay, it has no application regarding the situation when decree under section 11 or 12 is passed. You can clearly see it in section 12. It is mentioned here that whenever divorce decree is passed. All right, so when divorce decree is passed, it provides, the section provides that when can parties remarry again. Now we know that every decree of divorce passed under HMA is appealable. This is written under subsection 1 of section 28. You can see it. Okay, so appeal can be filed. So to prevent because you know that in appeal the order can be reversed. Okay, so to prevent any inconsistent situation, to prevent this predicament, the section 15, it provides that parties cannot marry till the time appeal has been dismissed or the limitation period for the filing the appeal against the decree of divorce has expired. Okay, so parties cannot marry till the time the limitation period for appeal against decree of divorce has not lapsed, or if appeal has been preferred, that appeal till the time that appeal has been dismissed. All right, after this they can marry. Now what shall happen if before this period, before the limitation period has expired, or before the appeal, if was preferred, has been dismissed, okay, the party, either of the party, married someone else, and later on in appeal that decree got reversed, what shall be the nature of that marriage? Section 15 does not talk about the nature of such a marriage, which is performed in contravention of that provision. However, we know that decree becomes operative as soon as it is pronounced. However, when it is set aside in appeal or reversed in appeal, it relates back the decision of the court of appeal, it relates back to the date of pronouncement of decree. It means that decree was never there. Alright, so the marriage performed in contravention of section 15 shall be void, because it shall be deemed as if there was no divorce between the parties, and parties were married, and the second marriage, it was performed during the continuance of the first marriage. Hence, that marriage is void as far as section 11 is concerned. Now, what about the penal consequences? Would parties be able to invoke section 17 and consequently section 494? See, as regard this part, there is no case law regarding this situation. See, regarding penal consequences, whether those penal consequences will be applicable or not if a marriage is performed in contravention of section 15. There is no case law regarding this situation. However, as far as the civil law is concerned, that is, what is the nature of second marriage? When the marriage is performed in contravention of section 15, all right, that marriage is definitely void. But regarding invocation of penal consequences, there is no case law. And my view is this, that for the purposes of criminal law, we shall not regard that such person has performed second marriage during the continuance of first marriage, because during that time the first decree was in operation. Okay, it later on got reversed, it later on got subverted by the decision of court of appeal. We have to do strict interpretation when we apply the principles of criminal law. Okay, so we further, so this one point that is left regarding question 15. I have already told you that section 15, it's relevant only in case of decree of divorce. However, same situation may arise even in decree of nullity given under or passed under section 11 or section 12. Those decrees are also appealable in nature. This can be seen under section 28 subsection 1. What if before such decree could be reversed, the other party married, and later on that original decree was reversed by court of appeal? See, regarding this, section 15 is silent, but clearly there are many cases of different high courts which say that similar thing has to be followed, which is mentioned in the section 15 regarding divorce, and the decree passed in the marriage performed during that period before dismissal or reversal of the order of court of original jurisdiction, that marriage is void because the court of appeal has reversed the original decision. Okay, so after this we proceed to section 16. Section 16 talks about the status of children born out of void and voidable marriage. Now I will like to tell you that what is the primary object of marriage. At the starting of the lectures relating to Hindu Marriage Act, I have mentioned to you that the primary object of marriage is to confer legitimacy upon children born out of it. If children are born to a couple who have not married, then such children are not legitimate. There are certain rights which are only granted to legitimate children, for instance, succession rights. A legitimate child can succeed to the property of father. However, an illegitimate child cannot succeed to the property of father. He is related only to mother. This is clearly mentioned in the Hindu Succession Act, Section 3J. Alright? And moreover, an illegitimate child, he does not become a co-partner, whereas a legitimate child becomes a co-partner by virtue of being born into that family. So there are certain rights which legitimate children they enjoy over illegitimate children. Okay, so if there is no marriage, children born out of it are illegitimate. However, if ceremonies were performed, but due to conditions mentioned under section 5 clause 1 or clause 3, sorry, clause 4 or clause 5, that is due to bigamous nature of marriage or marriage committed or performed within spinda relationship or prohibited relationship, such marriage is void, then children born out of it will not be illegitimate, rather they shall be legitimate. This legitimacy has been conferred by section 16. Similarly, if due to the conditions mentioned under section 12 the marriage is voidable and a decree of nullity has been obtained, the children born out of such marriage shall be legitimate. So legitimacy has been conferred on children born out of void and voidable marriages, and they are not illegitimate. They enjoy all the privileges which the children of normal marriage enjoy, that is, which legitimate children enjoy. However, subsection 3, it is a non-obstantive clause and it overrides the provision of subsection 1 and subsection 2 under section 16. It says that, okay, we accept that children born out of void and voidable marriage are legitimate children. However, they shall only succeed to the property of their parents and they won't succeed to the property of any other relative. So they won't be heirs as regards the property of any other relative, and they can succeed only to the property of their parents. All right, so this is mentioned under subsection 3. So their succession has been restricted, and only property of their parents is inheritable for them. Okay, so this regarding section 16, a recent case came, okay, in 2019, I think, before Supreme Court. I do not remember the name of this case, however it is a bit relevant in our lecture. In this case, what happened? Now, one of the state governments, I do not know which state government did this, but it passed a law regulating the compassionate appointment, where the children born out of second marriage, they were restricted from being chosen for employment on compassionate terms. We know that what compassionate appointment is. Under compassionate appointment, okay, the kin of deceased government employee, mostly their children, are eligible for employment because they do not have any other source of income. This is the criteria for justifying the compassionate appointment. Now, state government, it passed a law according to which if any government employee has performed a second marriage, which is bigamous in nature, then children born out of second marriage will not be entitled to be chosen for employment upon compassionate terms. However, the children born out of first marriage, which is valid marriage, they are entitled. But as regard void marriage, which is second marriage, they are not. Now, the court, Supreme Court, it observed this thing, that by doing this, by passing this law, you are destroying the object or purpose of Section 16. The main aim of Section 16 is to grant legitimacy, is to confer legitimacy upon the children born out of void marriage. And by passing this law, you are destroying the object of Section 16. And you have not mentioned any reason for making such a classification. So this is a class legislation, and Article 14 is violated, since there is no national nexus between the reason for classification and object sought to be achieved by that law. So the law was held invalid and ultra vires, because it destroyed the object contained in Section 16 of HMA. All right, so this was all for today. Thank you for watching the video. Please do share, subscribe and like if you liked the video. All right, thanks.